back to the year 73 after Hijrah. So Ibn Zubair is dead, Mecca and Medina in Al-Hijaz, Petra in Jordan, Al-Kufa in Iraq, all became under the rule of the Umayyad. He had full control on all of these cities, without any challenges to their rule. That lasted for the next 58 years. There was never a period of confusion or contention, as Dan Gibson called it. The Umayyad were in control from the year 73 till 132 after Hijrah. Dan Gibson continued his video saying, now we go to minute 54, second 58. He said, eventually Ibn Zubair lost the battle, but the cause was taken by those in the city of Medina in Saudi Arabia and by the city of Kufa in Iraq. I believe that during this time, the Islamic world was thrown into contention. Should they pray towards Petra or should they pray towards Mecca? The great Islamic empire had divided into two. End of quote. We say, no, it was not divided into two, and there was never a period of confusion about which Qibla or contention. After Ibn Zubair died, all the provinces came under the Umayyad. Medina, Kufa, Mecca, none of these cities or provinces took any cause after Ibn Zubair died. You know why? Because that cause, the Qibla, never was. If there was a second Kaaba in Mecca, the Umayyad would have easily wiped it off the face of the earth. But they did not, simply because it was the Kaaba, the only Kaaba. Now, after Al-Hajjaj won the battle, let us, for the analysis sake only, follow the narrative that this took place in Petra, just to see where this exercise is going to take us. In one time, he tells us that Al-Hajjaj could not rebuild the Kaaba because the black stone was not there. Notwithstanding the fact that the black stone is not essential for Muslims, the question arises here is why Al-Hajjaj did not bring it back from Mecca Al-Hijaz, which was under the Umayyad control. It would have took him a month at most to bring it back, not an issue considering the value of the Kaaba, but he did not. Wonder why. The second Dan Gibson story, that Al-Hajjaj rebuilt the Kaaba in Petra. Remember, we are in the year 74 after Hijrah. According to Dan Gibson, an earthquake hit Al-Petra in the year 94 after Hijrah, knocked down this Petra Kaaba, so people concluded that God knocked down this Kaaba as he favored the one in Mecca. Ignoring that Al-Kaaba was demolished and rebuilt many times before, but this never made the people abandon it, Islam and Muslims are not as naive as Dan Gibson thinks they are. The other question about this story, why there were two Kaabas till the year 94 after Hijrah, the year of the earthquake, according to Dan Gibson, when the Umayyad were in full power and full control over Mecca al-Hijaz, why they left the Meccan Hijaz Kaaba for 20 years, and actually another 30 years after that, when they could have easily demolished it and wiped Mecca al-Hijaz from the face of the earth. Third, was there really in Petra a strong earthquake in the year 94 after Hijrah, corresponding to 713 AD? There was an earthquake in that year, but not in Petra. It was in Antakya, in Turkey today. Its epic center was 650 kilometers north of Petra. That was too far to knock down a small structure with over a meter wall thickness, built in it wooden courses to absorb the tremor. But even if it was hit, build it again, like the many times before. Will you just abandon the true Kaaba, abandon the hometown of the Prophet, peace be upon him, where all your early Islam history took place, just not to build it again? I do not think so. And also, who are the people you are talking about when you said, eventually Ibn al-Zubayr lost the battle, but the cause was taken up by those in the city of Medina in Saudi Arabia and by the city of Kufa in Iraq. Who are these people who were in Medina and Kufa? Both cities were under the stronghold of the Umayyad for the next 58 years. There was no serious opposition to the Umayyad rule after the death of Ibn al-Zubayr, let alone praying and building mosques facing different Kaaba. There was no opposition, not in Medina, not in Kufa, and not even Mecca. These events were in 74 after Hijrah. Then in the year 132 after Hijrah, the Abbasids overthrown the Umayyad. The Abbasids are not followers or of the same family of Ibn al-Zubayr. They established their Abbasid dynasty, which lasted for centuries to come. But did they completely wipe out the Umayyad and rewrote the history? No, they did not. The Umayyad continued ruling the Andalusia in Spain for centuries to come. The Andalusian people were great intellectuals who left very important books in religion, science, history, and literature, none of which hinted that their enemies, the Abbasids, are faking Islamic history or praying towards a false Kaaba. There were also the Christians, the Jews, the Byzantines, and many other nations, all witnessed the Islamic Empire and wrote about it. Did any of them hinted about Petra's Islamic history? Zero. Not one single word. As we see, Ibn al-Zubayr, Al-Kaaba, the Black Stone, the wars, all took place in Mecca, that is Mecca al-Hijaz of Saudi Arabia. Before we leave these events, in all the extracts we took from the Muslim historians, there were no great importance given to the Black Stone. The only thing we know that it was fractured into three pieces and Ibn al-Zubayr put them in silver enclosure, which we have the same or similar arrangements today. Only now they are fractured in seven pieces. That takes us to the Black Stone. The Black Stone have no religious importance to Muslims, other than the Prophet, peace be upon him, touched it and kissed it. That's why Muslims have a sentimental feeling towards it. Al-Bukhari reports that Umar, Allah be pleased with him, came to the Black Stone when he was performing tawaf, kissed it and said, "I know that you are a stone. You do not cause benefit or harm. And if it were not that I had seen Allah's Messenger, peace be upon him, kiss you, I would never have kissed you." End of Al-Bukhari, quote. And from Al-Azraqi Akhbar Mecca, we quote, "The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said to Umar ibn al-Khattab, 'Umar, you are a strong man, and you hurt the weak. If you see no crowd, touch it. Otherwise, say, Allahu Akbar, and carry on with tawaf.'" End of extract from Al-Azraqi. Also from Al-Azraqi, narrated by Nafi' said, "I saw Omar's son pushing through the crowd to reach the Yemeni corner till he was exhausted. He left and sat on the side of the tawaf till he rested. Then he returned and did not leave till he touched it." Ahmad ibn Maysara said, "Abdul Majid told us, 'My father said, this is not compulsory on people to touch it, but my father liked to do as the Prophet, peace be upon him, did.'" End of extracts from Al-Azraqi. How many times a black stone is mentioned in the Holy Quran? Not once. Muslims honor Al-Kaaba and the Black Stone, same as they honor every mosque and every other religion relics. This does not mean that Muslims worship any of these. Muslims worship only Allah, the one and the only one, without associating anything with him. This is what the message which the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, came to deliver. In the Holy Quran, Surah 2, verse 125, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and when we made the house a resort for mankind and sanctuary, saying, take as your place of worship the place where Ibrahim stood to pray. And we imposed the duty upon Ibrahim and Ismail, saying, purify my house for those who perform tawaf, and those who meditate therein, and those who bow down and prostrate. Sadaqallahu alazim. End of the verse. So Al-Kaaba is the first house of worship put for mankind. Also in Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and to Allah belongs the east and the west, so wherever you turn, there is the face of Allah. Indeed, Allah is all-embracing and all-knowing. Sadaqallahu al-Azim. End of the verse. All directions are qiblas. Wherever we turn, there is the face of Allah. Allah is everywhere. Dan Gibson said in minute 55, second 13, he said, originally, the Umayyad that ruled from Damascus and they prayed towards Petra, but they were defeated in battle, and now the eastern part of the empire was ruled by the Abbasids, who all constructed their mosques facing towards Mecca. End of quote. What we understand from this confusing statement? As of the year 74 AH after Hijrah, the Umayyad alone ruled the western and the eastern parts till the year 750 AD, 132 after Hijrah. There were nothing called Abbasids till that year. When the Abbasids took over, they controlled the whole empire except for Spain, which stayed with the Umayyad. So there were no time when only the eastern part of the empire was ruled by the Abbasids. We come here to the end of this episode, to be continued in the next and last episode, which I call The Big Blunder. Thank you for watching. Please share this video and subscribe to this channel. Thank you. Wassalamu alaikum.